Broadside Books and Harper Audio present When It's Your Turn to Serve, Experiencing God's Grace in His Calling for Your Life by Karen Pence. This is the author. To my precious family, Michael, Sarah, Avery, Elena, Charlotte, Henry, Etta, Audrey, Dan. God sets the lonely in families. Psalm chapter 68, verse 6a. Introduction. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 24 says, "Gracious words are a honeycomb, sweet to the soul and healing to the bones." This book is intended to be an encouragement to each listener specifically. This is not a memoir, not a book about Karen Pence, but rather a story about how God used me in a mighty way and how He gently and patiently showed me how to wear the mantle He was placing on my shoulders. The purpose is not to shine a light on my life, but rather to highlight some of the initiatives in which I was privileged to be involved, to show the journey I traveled and the investments I made. Each of us on our own journey will be offered opportunities that, difficult though they may be, we can embrace or reject for the easy road. Everyone makes their own choices, and I do not suggest any specific path for the listener. Instead, I gently toss out some breadcrumbs to take you with me as I reflect on the paths I journeyed with God. As a child, I loved to memorize poetry. My favorite poet of all time is Robert Frost. When I was in the fifth grade, Robert Frost's daughter, Leslie, visited the school I attended. After her presentation, she gave me a copy of a collection of Robert Frost's poetry inscribed "For Karen, because you memorize poetry." I cherished that gift, and it encouraged me to continue memorizing his poems. My favorite is "The Road Not Taken." Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth, then took the other as just as fair and having perhaps the better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear, though as for that, the passing there had warned them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet, knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by. And that has made all the difference. I see my life as a blessing, but there have been struggles. My parents divorced when I was four, and I myself divorced my first husband. The life of a political wife, too, is far from glamorous or easy, however it may seem. There have been times when I, like you, just simply had to call up a girlfriend and vent. Times where I got on my knees, as the song "The Warrior is a Child" by Twyla Paris describes. I drop my sword and cry for just a while, 'cause deep inside this armor, the warrior is a child. Throughout my childhood and early adult years, as I would experience the struggles we all go through, my faith grew deeper and deeper. The Lord was the one who was constant. Through it all, I've tried to take the road less traveled and head the way that may look uncertain, especially if I feel it is where God is ultimately calling me to serve Him and others. And no matter what, He has always gotten me through and never abandoned me. He was always there. He still is. He is the reason I was able then and now to focus on the positives in my life, the blessings, and to take risks without fear. When It's Your Turn to Serve is meant to guide you, the listener, toward wearing the mantle, toward accepting the challenge, toward leading where you are called, to illustrate how, on my own journey, I was blessed by letting go of the safe and secure and embracing the risky and unknown. I learned the truth behind Psalm chapter 19, verses 9b and 10. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. When It's Your Turn to Serve. Chapter 1. Bees. Foraging honeybees have to fly around 55,000 miles to make a pound of honey, traveling to about 2 million flowers. I was running barefoot and free as a kid across a large field of grass and clover at a playground, and I remember it vividly. I stepped smack dab on a bee. It's not the kind of experience that makes a kid love bees, and I was no different. Like most children, I was wary of bees, knowing how much that sting can hurt. But in February 2013, I found myself sitting in a room full of other spouses of governors at the National Governors Association's annual meeting. Governors and their spouses convene at a bipartisan meeting once a year in Washington, D.C., to share ideas. Although each party also has their own separate sessions during the four-day weekend. I looked forward to this gathering each year while I was the First Lady of Indiana. Since the tenure of a governor is 4 years, discussing ideas and offering examples of what other spouses had done meant the spouses didn't have to reinvent the wheel. Once the election is over, the job of a first spouse begins in full force. It can be a confusing and stressful time. Everything is new. All of a sudden, you are expected to fill a role you've likely never been in before, all while getting your family adjusted to this new lifestyle. This organization comes alongside the spouses, providing advice and suggestions for maneuvering through this strange new reality. I welcomed how these experienced spouses took the newcomers under their wing, sharing the wisdom they had gleaned as they served. I had a lot to learn. Even though I had been a congressional spouse, I knew I wanted to use my time as First Lady of Indiana to make a difference. But where to start? This particular year, Ginger Beebe, the First Lady of Arkansas, delivered a fascinating presentation. She gave an entire demonstration sharing how she had bees at the Arkansas Governor's Mansion. Of course, we all technically had bees buzzing around our gardens, but she had a beehive. This was extraordinary to me. I had heard of colony collapse disorder, when most of the worker bees in a colony desert a hive, leaving the queen behind with food and some nurse bees to care for the young ones. I had heard about how we needed to come alongside our bees because some argue they are endangered. Not being a scientist, I didn't have the authority to weigh in on this issue. I just knew I could help honeybees, even if they aren't in danger of becoming extinct. I didn't want to wade into all of the political rhetoric and debates around what was affecting the bee population, but starting a hive seemed like an obvious way that I could do something to help. But it had never occurred to me before to have a hive. It had never occurred to me that I could support bees in my neighborhood, in my state. The Indiana governor's residence sits on 6 acres, which was perfect for a beehive. I knew nothing about bees, but I knew enough to know that I could help. I've found that God has a way of placing opportunities in my path, and this was one I wanted to investigate. Ginger's presentation was riveting. I learned how she used the hive to teach constituents in her state about bees, and then gave little bottles of honey as gifts from the governor's mansion. Suddenly, I found myself not feeling an aversion to bees, but rather a camaraderie with these creatures. My curiosity was piqued, and so began my fascination with bees. Years later, I was standing alongside a beekeeper in Montana, watching the myriad of bees flying all around his hive, as he told me that he could distinguish which bees were the ones returning to the hive as opposed to those heading out. Intrigued, I asked him how. He explained it was because the returning bees flew low to the ground and their sacs were full of pollen. I looked closer and I could see it for myself. The little pollen sacs on their tiny legs were full of yellow pollen. As they buzzed around, I could see how they flew lower as they carried more pollen. I thought of that conversation many times in the future as I reflected on what experiences I would bring back to my own hive, what lessons I could share. Having ventured far and wide like the bees in the roles in which God had placed me, I wanted to take what I had learned and apply it to my own life and help people along the way. As Romans 12:7a and 8 says, we have different gifts. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. I knew that if God placed me in a leadership role, in a role where He wanted me to be an encourager, then He would give me the grace to lead, as He will you, when He calls you to different times of leadership or service. The bees' work isn't easy or quick. They don't immediately see the fruits of their labor. They travel far and wide and work diligently. Like the bees' journey, mine was going to require diligence and patience and trust. And I would end up traveling quite far and wide too. Since then, the bees have been a constant in my life, teaching me not only about myself, but about God's creation and His plan for me. Whenever life takes an unexpected turn, I've thought about the bees and how God perfectly designed them for the task at hand, and how He has done the same for me and will help me along the way. Chapter 2, Surprises. Honeycomb cells have many uses other than storing honey. They are also used to store nectar, pollen, and water, as well as a nursery for larvae. It was 1984. I walked out of the church with my guitar in my left hand, headed to my little Honda Civic, parked under a big tree by the side door. It had been a great service, and I loved being part of the worship team. This was my home turf, near the neighborhood where I grew up, went to college, and then lived as I taught at a private school nearby. I was reaching into my purse to grab my keys when I was approached by a guy saying he was interested in joining the guitar group. I told him he needed to talk to the man with a beard, and he stuck out his hand instead and said, Mike Pence. I realized then that he wasn't really interested in joining the group, although he does play guitar and he could have backed it up, but that he was interested in meeting me. We had a nice conversation. I shared with him where I taught. He had thought I was a college student. He said he was in law school, and I told him my sister was also at the same law school. The conversation ended without him asking me for my number, so I didn't think much else about it. Interestingly, that church is right across the street from the Indiana governor's residence, where we would serve 30 years later. The next week, I was babysitting my sister's kids, and their phone rang. A man's voice asked for my sister. I explained that she and her husband were out of town. "Who is this?" he asked. I told him, and he promptly hung up on me. I think I shocked him. A few minutes later, Mike Pence called back after his buddy had teased him about hanging up on me. I told him I had thought it was him. He had been trying to call my sister to get the scoop on me. He had approached the registrar at the law school they both attended, but the woman was reluctant to give out personal information.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.